journeyed far, a weary pair. They sought for shelter from the cold night air, some place where she could lay her head, where she could give her babe a quiet bed. Was there no room, no corner there in all the town, a spot someone could spare? Was there no soul come to their aid? A stable bare was where the family stayed. Do you have room for a savior, and do you seek him anew? Have you a place for the one who lived and died for you? Are you as humble as a shepherd boy, or as wise as man of old? Come that night, would you have sought the light? Do you have room? A star arose, a wondrous light, a sign from God. This was the holy night, and yet so few go to see the babe who came to rescue you and me. This child divine is not.
God's word tells us in Isaiah 9:6, "For unto us a child is born, for unto us a son is given. And the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace." Hi, I'm Lisa Dennis Sparks, host of Believer Central World Update. From all of us at Christians United Broadcasting Network, may you have a wonderful Merry Christmas and a glorious New Year as we await together the soon return of the Lord Jesus Christ. God bless you and have a wonderful holiday.
Would you have come that night? Would you have sought the light? Do you have room? Will you come to? Seek the light. Do you have room?
Praise the King. Wow, that was really cool, CUBN. How about that? I enjoyed that. It was weird hearing my own voice, though, you know. Hey, guys. How's it going in the chat room? Wow. You know, oh, thank you. Thank you, Julie. Hey, Shanna, Clinna. Oh, there's my Janine and Julie and Melanie. Oh, glory. You guys, we're just going to have to really hang out when we get home. You know what? We can get together. Party at my house. You know, it might only be the size of an outhouse, but hey, we'll figure out how to fit in it, okay? Or bring your lawn chairs. Bring your lawn chairs. How's everybody doing? I love you guys. I'm so glad to see you. Well, we've got an interesting show for you today. Well, you know, I say that every day, don't I? But I'm fascinated by all this stuff. I'm interested in it. You know, it's fun for me. I love you too, Shanna. Hey, you know, it's hi, Daughter by Grace. It's nice to see you. Welcome. Welcome to all of you who are listening on worldwide over the airwaves and here in the chat room. We're going to lift up the name of the Lord Jesus Christ together today. We're going to learn some cool things, and we're going to find out what's going on out there. Now, there is a mystery, though. We've got an intrigue. An intrigue. King Abdullah. Israel National News has reported that King Abdullah died after back surgery in Riyadh on the 17th. But his aides are saying he's fine. So what do we know about this situation? Because Israel National News is an actually very reliable source of information. So what can we make out of this? Oh, hi, Clenna. Nice to see you. Oh, there's Wonder Woman. Hi. I'm so glad you guys are here. Looks like everybody's okay over there. Let's talk about Abdullah. He had this back surgery in Riyadh on the 17th. Israel says he's dead. His aides, the king's aides, say he's fine. So what can we make of this? Well, we've got King Abdullah is a very important person where the end time prophecies are concerned. The Islamic prophecies, okay? Now, I'm going to run through some of this with you and let you see what you think, okay? Now, I was looking at a video with some of this information. I can play it for you if you like. After I give you the information, you can decide if you want to see it, because it's an Arabic video. Now, it's got some English translations, but you know, it's like a half hour long video, and you'd have to really pay attention, you know. So what I did is I really paid attention, and I took like some serious notes. Okay. My handwriting feels every single one of these pages. Let me show you. It's my handwriting on this, on all of this. That's my notes about this situation alone. So we're going to go through these notes real quick. Well, you know how I can speed through things. So we're going to go through these, and what we're going to understand as we go through this is what King Abdullah's place is in the prophecies of Islam. Now, see, King Abdullah is not mentioned in the Bible prophecies. Now, we have the war, but see, the importance of King Abdullah is in the Islamic prophecies, not the Bible prophecies. So we don't know that that's a for sure thing, okay? But what the reason we're going to go through this is because it's important for us as believers, when we're trying to figure out what the big picture is here and what's going on, to understand how they think, what they think, and how they think, okay? And that'll tell us, if we understand how they think and understand the importance of the Islamic prophecies to them, then we can kind of anticipate their reaction. You know what I mean? Because we're waiting to see if this war is going to blow up. You know, it just looks like it's extremely serious. So we're gonna go. Yeah, that's some serious notes, Julie. I have no idea. Yeah, I mean, that's like 50 handwritten pages. I didn't even go to sleep last night. I went to bed at like 8 o'clock this morning. I was up all night because I want to know that's my responsibility. I have, you know, something this important occurs, I've got to know what I'm talking about when I talk to you, okay? Because it's really important that we get some accurate information. And this is serious stuff, okay? So now, Ahmadinejad of Iran, he was quoted as saying, whoever guarantees the death of King Abdullah of Saudi Arabia, I will guarantee the imminent reappearance of Imam Mahdi. That's the Antichrist. Okay? Their Mahdi is our Antichrist. Now, the Antichrist can't rise till we leave. Keep all this in mind. We're out of here before the wars turn into a really huge big deal. Okay? I believe we are also out of here prior to the destruction of Damascus. And we talked yesterday somewhat about how Syria is, you know, obviously absent from the scenario geopolitically, and these wars begin, which means Damascus is destroyed prior to this. Damascus being destroyed may be the event that actually rallies all these armies to come up finally, because they're kind of flaked out. We've got Lebanon, though. Hezbollah has called their fighters to arm and prepare to move against Israel. Hamas, you know, they're in no position to really do anything after Israel has pounded them. They took a real beating. And I mean, I feel bad for those, for the people, you know, who are victims of these cowards who, you know, fire missiles from schools and hospitals and hide behind children. But, you know, the Palestinian people, you know, our videos and our shows are able to be seen by the Palestinian people. And if, please let me urge you, precious Palestinian people, the God of Abraham loves you. He wants you to be blessed like Israel's blessed. But he has said, those who bless Israel will be blessed, and those who curse Israel will be cursed. And as long as you stand against Israel, things are not going to get better for you. Okay? If you really want for things to get better for you and your family, you have to let go of the hatred. You have to let go of the bitterness. And care about yourself more than you hate Israel. Hate, there's no part in us, in the Lord, that can bear hatred for the people of Israel. You just can't. The Messiah is a Jew. That's how it is. I'm not a Jew. You're not a Jew. Okay? The Arab people are, you know, they're Gentiles. Same as me. Same as everybody else who isn't Jewish. And, you know, I'm not a Jew, but I have to acknowledge from the scriptures that they are chosen. They are the bloodline of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And they are chosen. Now, look at, I mean, but, you know, before you get jealous of Israel, look at what it has cost them to be chosen, okay? For 6,000 years, you know, everybody on the planet has attempted to exterminate them. And God has caused them to be a scourge in the eyes of the world. It's not that they're bad people or anything, okay? This is supernatural. And the spirit of Gog, G-O-G, that is going to fuel these wars is anti-Semitism. Okay? It's the spirit that wants the people of God to be destroyed. People will rise from the east, preparing the way for the reappearance of Imam Mahdi. Iran is this country to the east. This isn't the Far East, China. This is Iran. Is to the east of Saudi Arabia. Where's my map? Well, I couldn't show it to you anyway. Analyzing the Hadith. That's their scriptures, okay? To solve the riddle of the reappearance. Now, I got all this out of their information, Okay. I'm learning this as they explain this to one another. And we'll see what. I'll run it by you. Analyzing the Hadith to solve the riddle of the reappearance. The Messiah will not rise unless fear, great earthquakes, and sedition take place. Now, that was spoken by the Imam Boker. No. The worst kind of humans will become leaders. That was a quote from the Prophet Muhammad of Islam. Women will rid themselves of the hijab. Imam Ali said that. These are their prophecies, okay, that they think are happening. Adultery will become common. Men will dress like women. Men will content themselves to men and woman to woman. Well, that's gay and lesbian. A nation from the east, that's Iran, will rise and prepare the way for the coming of Mahdi. Now, that's something the Prophet Muhammad has said. Hunger has spread to over 1 billion people, and that was as of 2009. Did you know that? 1 billion people on this planet were hungry in 2009, and it's worse now. The Hadith indicates leaders will rise from Lebanon, Yemen, and Iran, and are called preparers of the coming of the Mahdi. The Ayatollah Khomeini says, I tell you with utmost confidence the promise of Allah for the coming and the reestablishment of a new Islamic civilization is on its way. Now, doesn't that just make you feel all warm and fuzzy inside? Scary. The Hadith have clearly described the events and the transformation of various countries in the Middle East and also that of Iran in the age of the coming. Hokuyama, 1 month after 9/11, in an interview with Guardian, stated that Islam is the only cultural system that threatens the modernized West. He emphasized that in order to defeat the resistance of the Islamic countries, America can use its military might. After 9/11, America officially launched its project of Islam fear-mongering. America and its allies of 40 countries started the war against the Islamic world. Now, remember, this is not my opinion. This is their thing, okay? This is their thing. This is not my opinion. This is what they think, okay? In just a few years, they have dropped hundreds of thousands of bombs on the people in Islamic countries. Hundreds of thousands? Is that where all our money went? Okay. The events in Iraq, the war and bloodshed, have been described in detail that this land will be in center of conflicts in the age of the coming. Now, remember, Iraq, Iran, actually on Iraq's side is where the ancient ruins of Babylon are. And the USA has built what is called Fortress America there at Babylon. It is a 140-acre complex with 27 buildings and a wall around it that probably made the wall of Jericho look small. I mean, it's a fortress. They call it Fortress America. Billions and billions of dollars went into the building of this complex there. And that's probably, you know, it could be. Though after the reappearance, it will serve as the capital of world's governments of Imam Mahdi. See that? I think Brother J.D. Farrakh is right that, you know, It's entirely possible you're talking about literal Babylon, because they've rebuilt literal Babylon with this Fortress America complex. It's not, you know, it's right there on the spot, and it's all real fancy and gold and all of this stuff where Fortress America. The splitters will split and progress. The swift winged will attack. They're talking about American fighter planes there. The world turns away and anxiety will be plenty. They want to stir up fear. It's really, the fear level is really important. See, the forces of darkness, they feed on fear. Okay, wait a minute. I want to see what's going on. Oh, congratulations. God's Watchman says they're... an adoption is official, and she has a new cousin today. Glory to God. That's wonderful. She says, all of them in the Funk Walker clan and extended family are so happy. A little cutie. Okay, she says, okay, Lisa, not sure if the Saudi Arabian's prince dying has anything to do with it, but heard on the Blaze earlier, that's the Glenn Beck network, that Mahmoud Ahmadinejad, aka Iran, says it's the sign to start this Islamic war against Israel. Yes, I know that, which is why we're talking about this. Yeah, that's why it's so important. He's right. That's true. That is true. I've heard Ahmadinejad say that on television myself, that that's what they're waiting for. So I've known that. But Wonder Woman says, fear, anxiety equals psychotropic meds equals zombies. Well, you know, antidepressants will do that to you. Do you know that one time my doctor put me on antidepressants. He said I was depressed because I had, you know, I guess my shoulders were really tense or whatever. And he's like, you're stressed out. And I'm like, I am. I didn't feel like I was stressed out. I'm like, are you sure? I don't feel like I'm stressed out. And he's like, yeah, you're stressed out. Put me on these antidepressants. Well, you know what? Those antidepressants turned me into a whole different person. It was scary. My mom said, who are you and where is my child? It caused me not to care about anything. It caused me not to care about things. It's like it just kind of dumbs down your ability to care about stuff. And yeah, it keeps you from being, having any anxiety. That's for sure. Because you can't care about anything anymore. And if you can't care, you're numb. And if you're numb, you're a zombie because you can't feel anything. I'm getting way off, aren't I? My bad. Okay. Okay. Thank you, Dave. Okay. Let's see. Thank you for reminding me of that. Because these names, sometimes I can't tell what's what. A Wonder Woman says she was zoned out on antidepressants too. She didn't care. They want to put the whole world on antidepressants. And I have a really good doctor. I mean, he had every reason to feel, like I was probably under stress. But he just didn't know how they... I love him to death. He's wonderful. But he had no idea, how they would affect me. And what was it they put me on? It was like Effexor or something like that. Run for the hills from that stuff. It totally changed my personality. I mean, it turned me into someone who didn't care about anything. And can you imagine me as somebody that doesn't care? I know, it's preposterous, isn't it? I care about everything. I totally care about everything. It made you gain weight and made you angry when they started wearing off. Wow. Well, you know what? They say that you can't just stop those things, that you have to like be weaned off of them or something. But I just quit taking them. I didn't ever really take them, regularly. I tried to, but it did change my personality. And then I just quit taking them. I know you're not supposed to do that, but, you know, I do all kinds of things I'm not supposed to do. Well, what can I say? You know, it just depends on who tells me to do it and what it is. You know. Oh, wow. God's Watchmen. That is really weird that you would mention the Borg. Because you know what? I'm fixing to mention the Borg, okay? That's really weird. And it's not for the reason that you think. Get this. Okay. The New Jerusalem is a square, right? It's a square made out of gold. I was looking at this video where I was getting all this info, okay? And in Mecca, they gather around this big black square. And they kind of go mindless. They're chanting and they're like walking around the counterclockwise, this big, huge black square. And that's where all their energy or whatever is supposed to come from. And when I saw that big black thing in Mecca that they go around and chant and are all mindless, looks like a wave and all this stuff. Sorry. I mean, that is my impression of it, though, precious Arab people. It's what it looks like to me, okay? And it looked exactly like, I was thinking the Borg. That big black square looks like a Borg ship. And it reminded me of that because they're all of one, it's like they're all of one hive mind or something as they're chanting and going around this, you know, walking around this big black square thing. It looks like a bullshit. I'm telling you. It does. It looks like a bullshit. But anyway, I'm going to keep going here. The events in Iraq, the war and bloodshed have been described in detail. Remember, this is I'm reading from their perspective, okay? This is not my opinion. This is what they think, okay? Remember that. The events in Iraq, the war and bloodshed have been described in detail that this land will be the center of conflicts in the age of the coming. Now, when they're talking about the coming, they're talking about the coming of the Antichrist. Okay? Though after the reappearance, it will serve as the capital of the world's governments of Imam Mahdi. That's where we were talking about Babylon. They need fear. They need to generate fear. The world turns away and anxiety will be plenty. They will conquer Iraq and through bloodshed create divisions in tribes. Well, that's already happened. That's the U.S. went in there. Saddam was killed. And, you know, that's another thing. This prophecy was talking about how these three kings would fall, right? Well, now we've got three kings having fallen already without Syria being one of them. You've got Saddam, Gaddafi, and Mubarak. Okay, there's your three kings. And it's been a while since, I don't know about the Ba'ath Party, but Saddam, they pulled him out of a hole, you know, and got rid of him. But we've already got, you know, Syria is not one of those three kings. Syria goes up in a mushroom cloud. Okay, that's a whole different story. It said, their prophecies say that, you know, America will come over, conquer Iraq, and through bloodshed create divisions in tribes. And that's kind of what you've got there now. At that, and they say, at that time, be ready for the reappearance of the last Messiah, Imam Mahdi. Some believe that the ruthless dictator of Iraq, who will be killed in the age of the coming, is Saddam Hussein. See, these are older, these are not new prophecies. They believe that that Saddam's execution was prophesied here. The countries of the infidel, the Western countries, will take their army and their arms to the Islamic countries in the Middle East. But when they want to enter Iraq, they do so through war, and they enter from the south. These are past things, but that's their prophecies, okay? The events in Yemen on the threshold of the coming. It has been predicted by the Hadith that on the threshold of the coming, a holy revolution will take place in Yemen. Some believe that after the coming, the first soldiers of Imam Mahdi who will reach Mecca will be from Yemen. During recent years, the Shiites in Yemen have been under attack by a central government. Yeah. In the most recent conflict, the government of Saudi Arabia... Oh, I hear our break, don't I? Or do I? It's time for it, but I don't hear it. Okay. CUBN? Are we going to do the break, or should I keep going? There it is. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
This Christmas, I'm gonna say a little prayer. I'm gonna stop here for a moment before the moment disappears. The world's in a hurry this December. The city streets and shopping malls. I wish we could slow down and remember the meaning of it all. Wherever you are, no matter how far, come back to the heart of Christmas. Live while you can, cherish the moment, and the ones that you love, make sure they know it, and don't miss it. The heart.
Sorry, I had to recalibrate the camera there. Got all fuzzy. Welcome back to Believer Central World Update. Okay, we're in the thick of it. But I'm going to show you something real quick. Can you see this? Oh, let's see. Oh, can you see it? That is my grandson, Noah. That is my grandson, Noah. Mwah. He's 6 years old, and I'm just so proud of him. He's such a great kid. You know, I'm expecting my sixth grandchild. This is my oldest, my grandson, Noah.
Welcome to CUBN.
Are we back? Wow, we lost our connection or something. And I will show you something else. This is my husband. Oh, which way am I going here? Can you see? That's my husband. His name is Rick. Yes, that's me. This is when we went to Las Vegas with his company. They treated us to a trip to Vegas for some kind of a conference he had out there. And I'll tell you the truth. I couldn't wait to get out of Vegas, okay? I'm in Vegas and we're staying at the Venetian, yeah, you know what I'm talking about, right? I'm trying to think of what it's actually called. But anyway, we're staying at this hotel, and you've got these stores everywhere that, you know, sell souvenirs and stuff, and it says, "Welcome to Sin City." And people are walking around with, you know, these shirts that say Sin City. You know, and I'm like, my king, don't come while I'm here. I know there's believers in Las Vegas, but I don't live there. I mean, I had gone there to have some fun. And, you know, I went there to have some fun with my husband. But we did have fun. We went to dinner with his company, and they took us to the Cirque du Soleil. And that was a real interesting experience. Anyway, God bless everybody in Las Vegas, but I was sure happy to get out of there. I was really glad to get out of there. Well, it's just that we were right where we were in the thick of where we were. It was a lot of celebration of sin, and I just, you know, felt really out of place. I did. I just, Vegas just, it's, of course, it's everywhere, you know. Sin is everywhere. It's not just there. It's everywhere. But it just, I'm not wearing a shirt that says I had fun in Sin City or whatever. You know, I just, that's just not my thing. Oh, you know what? I felt that way, Shanna, in New Orleans too. You know what I could feel in New Orleans? This was before Katrina ever came through. We were down there and there was a buzz in the air that just was really irritating. it was a spiritual buzz in the air. You could feel it, you know, because spirits are territorial. There was a lot of occult, voodoo, black arts stuff I could feel in the atmosphere down there. And it was a very, how do I explain this? Spirits are territorial, okay? And they gather in certain places. Like, you've got a lot of occult and dark arts stuff associated with New Orleans. And then you've got spirits of greed that congregate in areas like Wall Street. You know, you'll have spirits of homosexuality gather and congregate in certain territorial areas like San Francisco. Okay. That's why you find certain sins concentrated in certain areas, because spirits are territorial. Okay. They occupy certain territorial areas. And yes, oppressive spirits. That's exactly right, Wonder Woman. And then you find the spirit of Gog is concentrated at Magog, which is Iran, Pakistan, and Iran, Afghanistan, and Pakistan. Right there is Magog. And that is where the bottomless pit is. That is where the seat of Satan is. That is where the spirit of Gog is concentrated and where it operates from. Okay? And that's why you have Iran, who is leading this charge into the destruction of Israel, because that's where the seat of Satan is. That's where the bad guy lives. That's where it's all going to come from. Okay? So let's keep going here. But anyway, that's my husband and my grandson. I just wanted to, you know, share a little bit of my world with you. My husband's going to be home in 2 weeks. I haven't seen him in 7 months. And hopefully we can still live under the same roof. Oh, I dearly love that man. He drives me insane. But, you know, I just couldn't. Nobody else would put up with me, seriously. Nobody else would ever put up with me. And the only reason he can is because he's gone all the time. So anyway. Okay. Now, in the most recent conflict, the government of Saudi Arabia attached the Shiites in Yemen. Attacked the Shiites in Yemen from the ground, the sea, and the sky. Okay. Meanwhile, the government of Jordan sent over 2,000 of its commandos to join in the attack with Israel and America. And they have issues with Jordan. Now, Egypt, the people of Egypt rise up against their ruler, creating a chaotic atmosphere. Well, tune in to any video about Egypt and you can see a chaotic atmosphere. The Hadith predict that the ruler of Egypt will be killed. So does the Bible. The Bible does too. Let me look at that real quick. Let's go to Daniel. Go over to Daniel. Chapter 11. Okay. Let's go to verse 25 in Daniel. And he shall stir up his power and his courage against the king of the south with a great army. And the king of the south, that's Egypt, okay, shall be stirred up to battle with a very great and mighty army. But he shall not stand, for they shall forecast devices against him. That's one thing this generation's wicked love to do. They love to get on television and tell you what they're going to do to you before they do it to you. They're forecasting devices. There's a lot of that. A lot of that. Let's see. Yay, that, in verse 26, yay, they that feed of the portion of his meat shall destroy him, and his army shall overflow, and many shall fall down slain. And both these kings' hearts shall be to do mischief. They sit down at a table together to do mischief, and they shall speak lies at one table, but it shall not prosper, for the end shall be at the time. For yet the end shall be at the time appointed. It's not the end yet. And see, these wars aren't the end. There's a lot that happens after these wars. Then shall he return into his land with great riches, and his heart shall be against the Holy Covenant, and he shall do exploits and return to his own land. Let's see, and it tells here. I need to find it for you. It tells that the king of the south, that's Egypt, that's this Egyptian president, it says that he will be killed by someone close to him. Somebody in his inner cabinet or his family or something like that, that they will poison him. Okay? So when Morsi is assassinated, then the country will be engulfed with conflict. The struggle for power and the rise in the popularity of Islamic groups like the Muslim Brotherhood and the uprising against Morsi. You know, this is going to be a real interesting situation. Events in Palestine will be the center of disturbance, insecurity, and sedition by the Jewish nation. Defending themselves as sedition? Imam Ali describes with clarity the role and destiny of the Jews in the Middle East during the Age of the Coming. Now remember, these are Islamic. This is what they think, not what I think. Okay. To establish its government in Palestine, the Jews will come from the West. During this time, the Arabs and their forces will be separated from one another and are not united. So this is talking about the past here. They asked Imam Ali, will this calamity and mayhem last long? He responded, no, not until the time when the Arabs rid themselves of the influence of others, take back control of their affairs, and once again have strong determination. At that time, they shall conquer the land of Palestine, and the Arabs will be victorious and united. Then extra forces will arrive from Iraq with flags which have Al-Ghova written on it. A-L-G-H-O-V-A-H written on it. The current Palestinian generation will witness the defeat of Israel. That's what the Iranian newspaper Kahan says. They wish. They attacked Lebanon, a mistake. They attacked Gaza, a mistake. They attacked those ships, a mistake. Now, this is what this video was saying. These mistakes, one after another, show that the murderous Zionist regime of Israel is reaching the final fall and destruction of its own non-existence. Once again, their words, not mine. I am a supporter of Israel. Okay? We are looking at these because it's important for us to understand how these people think and what they think is about to happen. The annihilation of the Zionist regime and the conquering of Jerusalem is one of the most important events in the age of the coming of the Mahdi. See, that's the Antichrist. The events in Saudi Arabia on the threshold of the coming are, according to the Hadith, the ruler will be named Al-Saud. These are hundreds of years old prophecies, okay? And upon the death of a ruler named Abdullah. Well, there hadn't been a king named Abdullah in Saudi Arabia for over 100 years until this one, okay? Upon the death of a ruler named Abdullah, conflict and struggle of power will increase in Saudi Arabia, and this will continue until the reappearance of the last Messiah, Mahdi. It is important to note that Saudi Arabia has not had a king named Abdullah in the past 100 years. In the presence of Abdullah, his illness, and his uncertain condition, they see this poor man's condition as great news for those anxious for the coming of the Mahdi. Mm-hmm. See, Abdullah has been in power since 2005. Events in Iran on the threshold of the coming. Now, these are the events expected from Iran, from their Islamic perspective. According to credible hadith, in the age of the coming, a revolution takes place in Iran, a great sign of the closeness of the reappearance, which serves as the preparer of the conditions for the worldwide movement in the coming of the last Messiah. A man from the city of Qum will call out the people toward the truth. He will be surrounded by those with iron hearts. These people have no heart, except an iron one. That's true. I'll have to agree with that, that they have iron hearts. They cannot feel. They do not value their own lives, their own children's lives. All they care about is destroying Israel because they are manipulated like puppets by the spirit of Gog, of the land of Magog, which floods the world with anti-Semitism. Storms will not weaken them. They won't tire from war and are not afraid of such. They depend on Allah, and tomorrow belongs to the righteous. Well, they got that right. In the end of time, descendants of Imam Ali will join ranks, their hearts close to one another through the cause of Ruhollah. That's said by the Prophet Muhammad. Imam Muhammad Baghir says, I can see that the oppressed will rise from the east and request their rights and justice. But when it is ignored, they draw their swords and confront the enemy, and that is how they succeed. But they are not satisfied until all will revolt to see the guidance of the last Messiah, and then killed will be one of martyrs. Analyzing the figures in the age of the coming. Important parts of the Hadith talk about certain key individuals prior to the coming, such as Sayyid Khorasani, Shosib Ibn Salach, and Yamani, and Sofiani, and Abdullah of Saudi Arabia. In order for the appearance to be close, these individuals must be present and active. They believe that, well, I'll keep going. As Sofiani moves, men will hide their faces. When Abdullah dies, the reappearance is guaranteed. This is their stuff. Okay? It says, when Abdullah dies, the reappearance is guaranteed. Many of the hadith, both from Sunni and Shiite sources, conclude that the figure Sayyid Khorasani is the leader of the people in the East, or one of their high-ranking officials who will pass on the flag of Islam to the last Messiah. They believe this Sayyid Khorasani, this leading figure, is the Ayatollah Ali Khomeini. Okay? They believe, let's see, the Hadith provides certain quality and signs of this leader, Sayyid Khorasani. A courageous man from Bani Hashem will rise from the province of Khorasan with Khorasani with black flags and has a sign in his right hand. They're talking about the mark. He has a sign or a disorder in his right hand. They're talking about the mark. He will prepare for the reappearance, will hand over flag of Islam to the last Messiah. Sayyid Khorasani has a strong and mobilized army. Sayyid Khorasani is a leader of the people who will rise up from the east. They believe that is the Ayatollah Khomeini. The Islamic Republic of Iran has scores of modernized warships, hundreds of modernized bombers, thousands of modernized missiles, and millions of willing martyr forces. After the meeting with the leaders, of the Zionist regime, the Joint Chiefs of Staff in America announced that in a confrontation with Iran, the option of a military confrontation with Iran, the option of a military confrontation is no longer possible. Really? That's news to me. Did you know America is talking to Iran and acknowledging that a military confrontation is no longer possible? Well, that's news to me. Is that news to you, too? I think that's new. That's news to Israel, too. But, well, Israel, they know all this stuff way before we do. Many of the scholars believe the Ayatollah Ali Khamenei is the leader Syed Khorasani. Now, who is, they believe that Yamani is Syed Hassan Nasrallah. He is the leader of Hezbollah in Lebanon. He's from the Shiites of Yemen, though, like the prophecies say, and his ancestors immigrated to Lebanon years ago. He believes he is a soldier of Khamenei. Okay, that's who he's following. These two, Iran and Hezbollah, coordinate the revolt against evil. Those are the two that are going to come against Israel right there, see. Now, the imposter. Now, the Islamics have an Antichrist. Did you know that? There's an imposter that they believe. One of the most important signs prior to the coming is the rise of the imposter, Islamic Antichrist. The imposter is described as a wicked being who will confront God's faith. There are many signs describing the imposter. Now, they believe the imposter is the Freemason. They say that the Freemasons are a secret society with the final goal of a devilish governance of the world with Jerusalem as its capital. They're probably right about that. Their belief is a devilish ideology with its roots dating back to the pharaohs. I agree. In the past two centuries, they have gained much power in the world. Okay. Freemasons have many signs, but the two most important ones are the all-seeing eye and the six-pointed star. Many important figures, including leaders of America, Europe, and certain traitor leaders of Islamic countries, are members of this evil organization, both in the past century and in current times. Some scholars believe that the formation of the country of America, and especially Israel, is directly connected to the activity of this group. Well, I would have said no way until I looked at the city street plan of Washington, D.C. that was created in 1773, and it's full of occult symbolism. It's so sad. You know, we have been so duped here in this country. We were purposely brainwashed, basically, to believe that all of this, that our nation was, you know, founded on Christianity. I think that our nation is Christian, and I don't care what anybody else thinks. Okay? I'm with you, Wonder Woman. She's just puking up a storm. Yeah. Yeah. God's Watchman says, wonder what would have happened if he exposed it all back then. Would they have killed him and laughed it off? No, I don't know who David Barton is. I'm actually quite sheltered in my little world. I study the Bible. And hi, David. Glad to see you. Hey, I'm just happy if anybody shows up. I'm thankful, and I'm honored that you guys would take your time and come and hang out with me. I'm tickled pink to see you guys. Here's another important figure. Shosib Ibn Salach, or whatever. It says that he starts his move 72 months prior to the coming, or 6 years prior to the coming of the Imam Mahdi. How long is that? Hey, does anybody know? I missed this. I'm sitting here thinking, how long's Ahmadinejad been in power? He starts his move 72 months prior to the coming. That's 6 years. Has Ahmadinejad been in there for 6 years? I wonder. That's something that I'll be needing to look into. Because this says that they think that this Shosib Ibn Salach is Ahmadinejad. Okay? Melanie says, Lisa, did you see the United Nations General Assembly has voted in favor of the birth of a Palestinian state? No. Oh, no. Have they? I was listening to that, and they hadn't got there, and, you know, my show was going to start, so I had to leave off listening. Really? Oh, carnage. Well, you know what? This is okay. This is okay because, hey, what good news. They're working in Congress to get rid of the NDAA. Hope it passes. Oh, that would be great, but let's see. I just stepped off the Senate floor, and the amendment to strip the indefinite detention language out of the NDAA could be voted on as early as this evening. Oh, you got to watch this. You have got to see this. This is something. On this video. It's so cool.
Drive the dark of doubt away. Give
Is that cool or what? Oh, I gotta get the fuzz out of the picture again. Wow, wasn't that cool? Did you guys like that? That was awesome. Our sister, Chris Geisbrecht, she put that on my wall and I just cried my eyes out. Isn't that cool? Oh, it's wonderful. Thank you, Chris. If you're out there watching, you just blessed our socks off today. I thought that was the coolest thing. I just started crying when I saw it. You know what? All of you guys that are locals in the Tulsa area,
welcome to CUBN.
Are we back? We're having trouble with our connection. Reekage. Well, anyway, wasn't that cool? I thought that was great. You liked that too. You liked that, didn't you, Janine? I did too. I did too. Hey. Yeah, we'd lose our connection periodically today for some reason. What can we say? The king is in control here, okay? And everything happens for a reason, and nothing happens that, okay, God's watchman. All of us, you know, I was thinking I'd really like to get together with those of you who would like to from the Tulsa area and go sing Christmas carols somewhere. You know, we could go to the mall or we could go to the river park or, you know, just somewhere and sing together. You know, wouldn't that be cool? I would really enjoy that. I would just really, really enjoy that. Well, we will, Clinda, did you move away? Well, you know what? I couldn't figure out what that link was on YouTube. Julie, go to my Facebook wall, sweetie. It's Lisa Dennis Sparks on Facebook. Go to my Facebook wall and it's on there. Okay. I think it's on the one with the dash, or maybe the check them both. It should be kind of close to the top. I can't remember which. David's giving us some end times headlines here. Breaking news: United Nations General Assembly has voted in favor of the birth of a Palestinian state. This is huge prophetically. I will be doing a live prophetic update at my church tonight. The message will be uploaded later tonight. Awesome. Could you please put it on my wall? The update, so I can snag it. Well, you know what? This is good for Israel. Okay, let's talk about this for a minute, what this means. This is good for Israel, though. Now, Israel has tried to keep this from happening. But now that if they are being recognized, I mean, they have voted in favor of the birth of a Palestinian state. Whoa. This is good news for Israel, and I'll tell you why. Because this gets Israel out of all the Oslo agreements. We've talked about that a little bit in the past. If the Palestinian state is declared its own thing, that absolves Israel of any responsibility to further carry the Palestinian people. Israel can just go, okay, you have your own state. There you go. They get all their water, their electric, their jobs, their food, their supplies, everything from Israel. So now that they're their own state, they have cut their own throats, because now all Israel has to do is shut those borders down and say, okay, this is not part of Israel. This is part of Palestine now. So we can shut it off and border it off. And we're looking at, you know, Israel can now defend themselves effectively. Do you know what? Israel could actually go in and do exactly what the Arabs did to them back in 1948 at the birth of the nation of Israel. If this is truly the birth of the Palestinian state, Israel could now do what they did and go and attack and take over. Take over the Holy Lands again. Because if they're their own state, then Israel's obligation is finished. They don't have to do a thing. They don't have to get, they don't have to collect tax money for the Palestinians. They don't have to get, make sure they can get supplies. They don't have to make sure they have jobs. They don't have to make sure that anything. And Israel's been taking care of them. See, they've just been biting the hand that feeds them. They're not self-sufficient. If Israel shuts them off, which they can do now, if Israel totally shuts them off, wah, wah, wah. Israel has every right to do that. Israel has warned them not to do that. But it was for their own good that they didn't do that. But now that they have, Israel can just go in there, that's right, Wonder Woman, and squash them and retake the land. Israel can go and retake all that land, and you watch, that's exactly what they're going to do. They're going to retake the land in this next war. Now, that doesn't mean that anything will happen tomorrow, although it could. This is a huge development that, you know, for the UN to vote for the birth of a Palestinian state is spitting in the face of Israel. And the speech from the Israeli ambassador that I was hearing earlier was basically laying that right out, saying if you declare a Palestinian state, you're spitting in Israel's face, basically. And but you know what? That's not surprising. The United Nations is full of Muslims, okay? It's all Muslims. They run the whole thing. And so it's not a big surprise. The UN, 95% of the resolutions they have come up with since their inception were against Israel, okay? There can be fighting and slaughter anywhere else in the world, and they'll ignore it. But they've got to get rid of Israel. You know why? Because Israel is the beacon of the knowledge of God in the world. They are God 101 for the world. And, you know, the spirit of Gog, the spirit of wickedness. Oh, it's snowing. Where's my blankie? Where's my blankie? Okay. I got it. Okay. Yeah, it's cold. Brr. Maybe I should put my coat on. Isn't that cool? I love all those effects that Cuban can come up with. I love the snow. Let it snow. It's all good. I can handle it. Okay, let's keep going. I know, David, it's on my wall, the video that we just watched. It's not a YouTube video. What you have to do is click on the link on my wall and just follow that picture until it gives you an option to embed on a website. And so I didn't find it on YouTube. It was Chris put it on the wall, and I had to track it down just to get a link to give it to Cuban. Well, here, let me give you the link of the one I sent to him, and let's see. I'll find it for you here. Isn't that a cool video, though? I thought it was really cool. I'll go to my Facebook here real quick. Click on it. I'll follow it. And it, let's see. Well, let's see. How do I follow it? I'm not real sure. How did I get that link for you, Cuban? Well, and I don't see it on the thing. Well, try okay, let me come over here to the chat room. I'll try to post this link here that I've just snagged. Hopefully that'll work. Try that link there and see if it'll work. Chrissy, you're not in Mo's chat. Oh, she's over there listening to RPM, I think. Yeah, the one. Let's see. We've got, okay, let me explain this to you guys. The chat rooms, the one that says End Time News at the top is the chat room for Blue Ridge Central World Update right now. And the one below it that says the word at the top of it is RPM's chat room. Okay. So now they're separated out. Okay. Let's keep going. Wow. You guys can let me know if that link works or not. Hopefully it will. Okay. So they think now that this Yamani is what's his name? Syed Ibn Salach or something like that. The Syed Khorasani, they think that's Khomeini. The Soshib Ibn Salach, they think that is Ahmadinejad. And then they believe that that Syed Khorasani is Khomeini. The Soshib Ibn Salach is Iran's Ahmadinejad. And then Yamani is the Syed Hassan Nasrallah. Okay. Let's see. Okay. Well, I'm going to keep going here. Yes. Is it? I wonder why. I wonder what the deal is. No, I don't. I mean, I had like a couple of them, but here, I'll take this. Let me take this down. Really? What did it? Okay. Okay. That's what's happening. Okay. Well, I had gone after that link and it started the video. Yeah, thanks for letting me know that. Okay, and I'll go here and close some of these windows here. Oh, okay. Now I'm going to give you guys in the chat room, this is the link for the video that I got all of this information from that I'm reading to you now. Okay. Wait. No, this one is the link that I pulled off. That's the singing in the mall. Okay. And then this next one is the video of the Muslim information that I'm giving you. Wait, did it do its thing? There you go. Okay. Now, let's keep going here because there's a lot of really good information and we still, golly, I can't believe we so far into this.
Welcome to CUBN.
Wow. Okay. Oh. Are we okay now? Wow. Okay. Well, CUBN says we're okay now. Well, let's keep going. All right. Now, if this guy is, if this Shahib Ibn Salah is Ahmadinejad, it says he will start his move 72 months prior to the coming. 6 years. Now, how long? We'll have to figure out. Thank you. Isn't Cuban cool? 72 months before the coming of the Mahdi is when Ahmadinejad starts his move to diss Israel. That's 6 years. It says he'll be appointed to the commander-in-chief by Syed Khorasani, who they think is Khomeini. It asks, can he be the great commander of Islam at the time of the coming? Ahmadinejad, that's who he thinks he is. He thinks that, you know, he's destined. That's what's so scary about him. The hadith says that he has the confirmation of Khomeini and is appointed as the commander of Iranian forces on the threshold of the coming. Now, his final goal of conquering Jerusalem, and on the threshold of the coming, he will conquer the holy place. Now, Ahmadinejad says, Palestine, with the full strength of resistance and power of faith, will become free. Justice will come. The oppressed will be saved. Well, we're just seeing in the United Nations today the birth of Palestine. Well, you know what? They were offered their own state back when Israel got theirs, and they turned it down. They just have, they still refuse to acknowledge the existence of Israel. So this is not going to be a good thing. I mean, this is going to be bad, okay? Okay, let's see. The son of Imamat is about to rise. Come forth with jihad to serve God. They hope to see the beautiful face of the last imam in the very near future. Oh, this is where I had my notes about the big black box they chant around and walk around in Mecca. It does look like a Borg ship. And they're all kind of one hive mind, you know. That's what the mark's all about. Did you see the video? Did you see the video where they had they put electrodes in the bull's brain. And it was, when it was coming at the matador, they flipped a switch and the bull freaked out and stopped its attack. That's what they hope to do. If you have the mark, they can control you. If you have a chip, they can control you. They can kill you by remote control if you won't take the mark. Did you know that? Because the chip might be the mark, but it might not. I mean, the chip might be a prelude to the mark. But you don't want to take it either way. Because, see, the mark might just... Oh, you found it on... Oh, good. Good. Here, let me snag this real quick. She's found this on YouTube. Oh, good. Let me snag the link real quick. Well, how do I get on there? How do I get on YouTube here? Yes. Are you serious? It's still, I thought you said it looked better. Okay. I just tried to tried to turn this video on, so I will turn it off. Well, heck. Okay. Really? Well, can you reset it one more time, and then I just won't open anything else. We're going to reset one more time, guys. We'll be right back.
Welcome to CUBN.
Okay, we've got... how's that? Great. Okay. All right, I will quit opening things. All right, let's keep going here. We're actually making a really good dent in these pages here. Okay. And it's only taking us an hour and a half to do it. It says here that now some of the errors, I saw another video too that presented what it says is errors in the first video. Now, this video said that error number one was that the belief that Jerusalem has to be captured by armies and that Israel must be destroyed in order for Hazrat Mahdi to appear is an error. Okay? So, and that's right. We know that because the Antichrist, their Mahdi, shows up and Israel isn't destroyed. He brokers a peace treaty. Okay? Second error, the belief that the soldiers of Hazrat Mahdi must wage an armed struggle against the way of the Dajjal. That's the anti-Messiah. Now, they believe the Dajjal is like the Illuminati and all them, okay? Error number three, the belief that Hazrat Mahdi will need a powerful army in order to appear. Error number four, the belief that a military alliance is needed against the war against evil. Lebanon's forces have been called to arm and prepare for war against Israel. This is serious business, guys. They are arming. As Nasrallah has called up the Lebanese Hezbollah forces to be prepared to go to war. Error number five. Now, that wasn't an error. That's me telling you something else that I've interjected in there, okay? The belief that Mahmoud Ahmadinejad will capture Jerusalem with his armies before the coming of the Mahdi. It won't happen. That is an error. That's right. Error number six, they're awaiting the death of Saudi King Abdullah. Now, this is where we want to get to. Excuse me. They're awaiting the death of Saudi King Abdullah and disorder in Saudi Arabia for the coming of Hazrat Mahdi. Now, we're just about to see if this one plays out to be true. Now, we don't know. There are conflicting reports. There have been reports. Israel National News has reported that King Abdullah died on the 17th after back surgery in Riyadh. But King Abdullah's aides are saying he's fine. But this would make sense if a... Now, I believe Israel. They have intelligence and they would know. It makes perfect sense that Saudi Arabia's, the king's aides, goodness, I'm catching my throat. It makes perfect sense that the king's aides would say he's okay because of these prophecies that tell them after Abdullah dies that all heck is going to break loose and that their successor, that Abdullah's successor isn't going to be able to hold the kingdom together, that it's going to fall apart. So they have all kinds of reason to not want people to know that Abdullah is dead. But Israel, I can't really picture Israel National News saying he's dead if he's not dead. You know what I mean? And it's real easy to put a turban and a mustache on somebody and make them look like Abdullah and put them on television. Okay, I mean, anybody looks like the guy if you put a mustache on him and a, you know, the headdress and all that. Everybody looks exactly like him. And if you've got his brother dressing like him, Yeah, it's entirely possible, because it's just, you got to think about, why is Israel reporting that he's dead? The Mossad is everywhere, okay? They are wizards at intelligence. They know everything. And so I think the guy's dead, since Israel says so. And it makes perfect sense to me why they would lie in Saudi Arabia, because the prophecies say that when Abdullah dies, their country's toast and it's going down, and they're thinking, uh-oh, what are we going to do now? They don't want anybody to know. They don't want their country to fall. But they know the prophecies. Everybody does. What do I do here? Okay. When the death of Abdullah, king of Saudi Arabia, is confirmed, it will signify the coming of the Mahdi is imminent. And wow, we have major, we got major news today, don't we? The birth of a Palestinian state. This is a trip, guys, because now war is imminent, okay? And the rapture before the wars, unless they're small skirmishes like Gaza. The whole region is not going to blow up while we're still here. I really don't believe that's the case. And here's why. The description in the Bible of the wars, Syria is not a part of it. Okay? Now, if all the Arabs were coming against Israel, Syria would be involved. And I don't know, Syria's kind of isolated right now, but Syria would jump at the chance to come against Israel. They would. The one thing you can count on out of all of the Middle East is that the anti-Semitism, the spirit of Gog, is going to dominate everything else. The Arabs can't get along with each other to save their lives, but they have one common goal, and that is the destruction of Israel. But the scripture says that the Arabs will turn on each other and kill each other. Okay? A madness comes over them where they turn on one another and kill each other. I don't know. I mean, it sounds like an act of God to me. But it says here, the coming of the Mahdi is certain once King Abdullah dies. Whoa. That's what they're saying. But, you know, these are not Bible prophecies, okay? So, it's just speculation is what I regard it as. I mean, I don't regard these prophecies as any kind of sure thing unless they agree with ours in the scriptures, you know? Let's see. God's Watchman says, well, that's just the thing, Lisa, that gets me and many others. What about Matthew 24, not just the unknown day and hour, but the wars, rumors of wars, birth pangs, etc.? Are we more in the Matthew 24 times, or more in the Dan and Revelation, or combo of all three? Matthew 24 focuses first on the Great Tribulation. Okay? Let's go over there real quick and I'll show you. Let's go over to Matthew 24, and if you start at verse 1, let's pray, okay? Our show's almost over, we're just now getting to the Bible. All right, Janine, can you still hear me, dear? Can you hear me, Janine? Okay, you guys can hear me. Okay. Let's go ahead and pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we bow before your throne and thank you, my King, that you love us, that you came and died for us. We honor and praise and worship you. We give unto you all that we are, O Lord. Unto you I give full control, my King, of all I think, say, and do. Cause me to be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, and cause us together as a group to lift our hearts and our minds towards you, my King. Grant us understanding into your word and plant the seed of your word in good soil in our hearts, mighty King, that we may bear fruit abundant for you. In Jesus' name. Okay. Let's go. I'm with you, Clinna. Let's, Elijah, bring Elijah in here. You know, do you know that I asked God for, I don't know if I'll ever get it, but I asked God, you know, Elisha asked for a double portion of Elijah's spirit, and I asked God for a double portion of Elisha's spirit. Now, I don't know if I'll ever get it, but I asked for it. You can't get what you don't ask for, right? But you know what? You know what's really cool? He might have given it to me in one respect, and I'll tell you what that is. The sheer number of people that we today, as servants of God, are able to reach would stagger those ancient prophets, because they actually had to talk in person to people and walk around to towns and all this. And here we, you know, I can sit in my studio and tell the whole world that Jesus Christ is coming. Now that's amazing, isn't it? Isn't that something? Okay, now let's go back on Matthew 24. Okay, we have Revelation, with some things in Revelation are starting to come together, but chronologically, those events have not started yet in Revelation. Okay, right now, if you look at where we are chronologically in Revelation, we are in the church, the letters to the churches. Okay, and then in chapter 3, verse 10, the king promises that he will keep us from the hour of temptation. That's the rapture. Then the church of Laodicea is the tribulation saint. Okay? And then you go from there. And then in Revelation chapter 6 is where we have the seals begin to be opened. So we're not really in Revelation yet, unless we're in the church letters, you know, chapters 2 and 3. But very shortly, you're going to start seeing these events come to pass. It's just totally amazing. Okay. Now, what are you saying here? God's watching. Matthew 24 is so complex. The one thing is no one knows the day or the hour. Okay. But we're for sure in the season of the end times. But we got wars, rumors of wars, birth pangs, etc. Have yet to see the sun darkened, moon as red as white. What a... Those are great tributes. The sun darkened, the moon turned to blood, all that. That's great tribulation. Okay? Now, if you go through the... Let's go through the 24 here. Now, in the first few verses, you have the disciples asking, what is the sign of thy coming and the end of the world? Okay? Then Jesus starts out with 70 AD events, too, all right? Because that's what was pertinent for them. But these 70 AD events also foreshadow future events, okay? Now, you go through from 5 to about 14, and you've got 70 AD events that also foreshadow future events. And we do have the beginning of sorrows, I believe, is the rapture. The rapture is not sorrowful for us. It is for those who are left behind. But I think when it says all these are the beginning of sorrows, I think it's entirely possible that the rapture is... Because, see, the rapture is going to wake up the whole world spiritually. Right now, the world's asleep. And it's supposed to be asleep when the rapture occurs. If you have an event like the destruction of Damascus with nuclear war, or the Antichrist actually showing up on the scene, saying he's God, then and you have the church is not here for those things. Okay, the Antichrist can't be revealed while the restrainer of evil is in place. The restrainer, which is the Holy Spirit indwelled believers, is restraining evil right now. But when we are removed from the equation, then you have a world of unrestrained evil. And then that's the beginning of sorrows. Whoa, that's going to be bad, bad news. And then at verse 15, you're starting from 15 through 28, you're looking at great tribulation events, okay, in Matthew. And then 29 through 31 is just right after the end of the tribulation. But then when you go back to 32, then you're going clear back to the beginning of, now verse 32 through 34 tells us the conditions of the prophetic generation, how it's birthed, the birth of the nation of Israel, that Israel is the fig tree. If you go to Hosea, you find out who the fig tree is. You find out it's the patriarchs of Israel. So that's no doubt that the fig tree is Israel. The branch being tender, that's the Holocaust that started the nation. I know this is weird because we've always learned that 1948 was the birth of the start of the generation. It was the birth of the nation, but not the start of the generation. I thought those two coincided, but they don't. I'm in Matthew, David. Matthew. Yes, and so when you've got Matthew 32 through 34, that tells us that Israel will go through the Holocaust, the nation will be born, and to know that the king's return... To know that the king's return is at hand when we see those things. And so in verse 32, we find out that the birth of the nation was 1948, but the birth of the generation, I'm learning, is different. The birth of the generation was 1941 when the Jews began to be slaughtered, the tender branch. See, that's the first thing it says. Now learn a parable of the fig tree. This is verse 32. When his branch is yet tender and putteth forth leaves, you know that summer's nigh. That's the first event it mentions, and I should have thought of that, but sometimes I'm just really, really dense. Okay? So then it says, when you see all these things, this is verse 33, know that it is near, even at the doors. So we have the birth of the generation 1941. That means the king is going to be back by 1921, probably in the fall. The fall is where the treaty and his return and all those feasts are demonstrated. So if he comes according to, you know, the timing of the feast. But one thing that we do know, we're 9 years away from the end of the generation. That means the tribulation period has to start 2 years or prophecy fails. Easy as that. Easy as that, because we're interpreting it the way we've interpreted all the rest of the prophecies that have come to pass. Jesus teaches us how to interpret the prophecies by watching the other ones come to pass and seeing what happens there. That's how he teaches you how to read these things. And then you look at the fulfillment, you look at what the Bible says, and then you kind of get an idea of how God does things. Now, let's see. David says, the generation is the final one of Israel. I always thought they were talking about us, those alive during these times, not just the Jews, but the Gentiles who are saved and grafted in the branch too. No, see, everyone who has trusted in Christ has been raptured. Now, what happens is Israel must go through Daniel's 70th week. That's what this tetrad coming up in 2014 and 2015 is signifying, is the the tribulation period, Daniel's 70th week, must occur. And that's Old Testament, okay? Israel has never really come out of the Old Testament into the New. They're going to rebuild their temple. They're going to start the animal sacrifices over again as soon as this treaty is started. You're going to, everything's going to go whoosh right back into OT times. Everything's going to be back based on the law and the beacon, God 101, Israel. Yeah, it's, but listen, it may look like these wars are going to blow up any second, but they won't, okay? They won't. Because we have to leave first. They can't blow up until the Antichrist comes, and the Antichrist can't come until we leave. So see, the sooner, that's why I keep telling you that the closer the wars look, the closer the rapture is. Because, you know, if it looks like the wars are about to blow up in our face any day now, just think how much closer the rapture is, because that comes before the wars. And it doesn't mean there won't be skirmishes like, you know, Operation Pillar of Defense and Cast Lead and all these things. But I'm saying the destruction of Damascus requires seal judgment. Okay? I really believe that. Because seal judgments are war way magnified. You know, the seal judgments are things that we've already had here and have always had here, but they're just turbocharged, you know? They're not, like war now, you know, is missiles and drones and guns and things like that. War in the seal judgments is nuclear. It's on a whole nother level. That's why the seal judgments are things that we've already seen on a whole new level, just like the global famine. You know, and Antichrist. Antichrist, there's been tons of Antichrists, lots of them, but this one is turbocharged, okay? This one's going to have supernatural power. This one is going to be able to do miracles where people can see him and they'll think he's God. Now, on the wars, you know, it's the same thing. You've got your conventional, regular kind of wars, like Hitler and them were your conventional, regular kind of Antichrist. Then you're going to have this guy that's turbocharged. Then the wars, turbocharged wars, nuclear. Then with the famine, we've always had famine. But you've got, but you've got a global famine. This is a famine turbocharged on seal judgment number 3. And then seal judgment number 4. So you've always had massive deaths of things, of, you know, millions of people, even through pneumonia pandemics and things like that. But this is mass death on a whole different scale. We're talking 2 billion people will die. And so, wow, you know, are you guys hanging on? Are you still got hold of the reins? I didn't leave you behind any.
Welcome to CUBN.
Wow, CUBN. I wonder what's the deal. Do you know? Well, I'll talk to you about it after we get done here. I only got 9 minutes. Okay. Anyway, after verses 32 through 35, okay, then you have the unexpected coming of Christ. Now, the unexpected coming of Christ is the rapture, because the second coming is scheduled, all right? Everybody's going to know exactly when to expect him at the second coming. Once they see the abomination of desolation, when the Antichrist defiles the temple, the Jews flee. They will mark that day, and then they will follow the instructions and the math in Daniel chapter 12, and they'll know exactly when to expect the Lord Jesus Christ, okay? So, the unexpected coming of Christ is the rapture, okay? Now, in verse 36, I'll show you something cool here. But of that day and hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. If you look in the book of Mark, at the scripture there, it's another account, and it adds that the Son doesn't know either. Well, Mark didn't know what he's talking about. Of course Jesus knew. He's God the Father in a human body. And we know that for a fact because he said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. And the scripture that I quoted you from Isaiah 9:6 that says, for unto us a child is born, for unto us a son is given. Okay? And the government shall be upon his shoulder. And his name shall be called a Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father. Okay? The Prince of Peace. He is God the Father in a human body. Jesus Christ is. Did you know that? That is pivotal to our faith. That's why, that's what makes it, you know, that's what makes Mormonism, you know, in error and Jehovah's Witnesses in error. They believe that Jesus is a created being, that he's not God in a human body. Okay? And he is God in a human body, the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, even the Quran says that he's the Holy One. And it doesn't call Muhammad the Holy One. It calls Jesus Christ the Holy One. So, anyway, these scriptures, what I was going to get to here, these scriptures in 36 through 44. 36 through 44 are talking about the unexpected coming of Christ, which is the rapture of the believers. Now, it says in verse 37, but as the days of Noah were, now we talked about that. I'll run that by again. You'll notice many of the saints in the Bible have two names, okay? Noah and Noe, Elijah and Elias, Peter and Saul and Paul. Okay? The reason they have two names is because there is a carnal person, and then after they know Jesus, there is a new creation in Christ that has a different name and is a whole different person. So when it says as the days of Noe, that's the carnal Noah. And it's telling you about his time, the carnal time, okay, not the faith Noah. And it says it also shall be in the coming of the Son of Man. Now, what that tells us, the days of Noah were, the world was filled with the Nephilim. The fallen angels had come, taken wives. We read about that in Genesis chapter 6. They took wives and bore children. So these children were Nephilim. They are human bodies with no soul inside. Okay? God has, they can make a human body through physical reproduction, but they can't make a soul. And God does not grant a soul to these Nephilim bodies that are produced through reproduction between fallen angels and human women. Okay? He doesn't make a soul for them. They're empty human bodies when these Nephilim are born. And a fallen angel steps into that human body and drives it like an avatar. And then when that human body dies, they live a human life in it. Then when that human body dies, they just hang around out there. Okay? They don't have a redemption plan. The Nephilim do not have a redemption plan. Pure humans, we go straight to heaven or hell. Absent from the body, present with the Lord. But the Nephilim, they have no redemption plan. They have nowhere to go when they leave the human body that they've lived a life in. So that's how you find out that, see, these Nephilim, they're the explanation for reincarnation, past lives, ghosts, all of that. They are the Nephilim that are just hanging out there. And at the end of time, they're cast into the pit. But they're just hanging out there right now. They don't have a redemption plan. And thank God we pure humans have a redemption plan. Aren't you glad? Because, see, to give them a redemption plan, Jesus would have had to become one of them and die. But he didn't do that. He became one of us and died for us. So, isn't that good? I can't believe we're down to 2 minutes. I love when you guys come over and hang out with me. You know what? I'm always so sad when the show's over. I look forward to seeing you every single day. But these scriptures in 36 through 44, let's keep going. 38, for as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating, drinking, marrying, giving in marriage till the day that Noah entered into the ark. See, it was Noah that entered into the ark, and it was Noah that stepped out of the ark. Okay? And they knew not until the flood came and took them all away, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. How many people do you see out there walking around totally oblivious to the events going on in the world? Well, we're seeing these events that's happened at the UN. We have witnessed today, my friends, the birth of a Palestinian state, and all Hades is about to break loose over there. So let's keep our eyes to the grindstone. I'm going to be producing... I hope I can get to a nutshell tonight. I might not be able to. I got to get out there and get my Christmas lights up. All my neighbors have beat me to it. And I'm usually the first one. I've usually got them up like Halloween, you know. So I'm going to have to go get those up. I got to have some color in my yard. All my neighbors, I'm so proud of them. They just do such a good job. And they've all got their lights up. And the Jenners have their lights up. And the Spears have their lights up. I'm so proud of you guys. I'm going to go get mine up too, okay? But I love you guys. We'll see you again tomorrow, should the Lord tarry, here, there, or in the air. God bless you.
I'm going to make a wish this Christmas. I'm gonna say a little prayer. I'm gonna stop here for a moment before the moment disappears. The world's in a hurry this December. The city streets and shopping malls. I wish we could slow down and remember the meaning of it all. Wherever you are, no matter how far, come back to the heart of Christmas. Live while you can, cherish the moment, and the ones that you love, make sure they know it, and don't miss it, the heart of Christmas. The way it used to. Let's find the wonder of a child. You can see the magic all around you. Come on and open up your eyes. You can find it in the warm embrace of your family, or calling up a long lost friend. You can even find it in the eyes. Wherever you are, no matter how far, come
gonna say a little prayer. Wherever you are, no matter how far, come back to the heart of Christmas. Live while you can and cherish the moment and the ones that you love. Why?